Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. The next item of business is a debate on motion 8291 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on expansion of vocational and technical qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools. I'll just allow a moment or two for members to change seats. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons? And I call on Shirley Ann Somerville to speak to and move the motion up to 13 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. And I'm delighted this afternoon to celebrate the expansion of vocational and technical qualifications on offer to senior phase learners in Scotland's secondary schools. It's almost a decade since we launched Developing the Young Workforce, our youth employment strategy. In schools, this has resulted in a significant increase in the number and type of vocational and technical courses and qualifications that secondary schools now offer. It has been possible because Curriculum for Excellence provides a broad framework within which educators are empowered to provide learning and teaching experiences that best suit the needs of individual learners. In this time, secondary schools have significantly expanded the curriculum opportunities for learners to develop skills for and experience of work. We owe a huge debt of gratitude to all those in their roles in schools, local authorities, colleges, employers, third sector organisations and indeed the wider communities who have worked to provide the ever-increasing range of opportunities for our school learners as part of their curriculum. Just last month, official statistics showed that in 2022, a record number of school leavers went on to work, training or further study. And I want to congratulate those learners, especially those who faced significant disruption due to the COVID pandemic during their senior phase of secondary school for their achievements. These statistics show that the percentage of 21-22 school leavers in a positive destination was the highest on record. The gap between the school leavers from the most and least deprived areas progressing into further education, training or employment has narrowed to a record low of 4.4 percentage points. This is a reduction of two-thirds compared to 2009-10. This success is replicated across Scottish education. We see the number of school teachers in Scotland increase since 2007. Overall pupil teacher ratios remain at near record levels, with the current ratio of pupils to teachers maintained at 13.2, its lowest level since 2009. We spend more per pupil and have more teachers per pupil than any other nation in the UK. And the resilience and hard work of our teachers and young people is extraordinary. Last year, we saw one of the strongest ever set of qualification results in an exam year compared with 2019, the last year where we had exams. Pass rates for NAT 5, higher and advanced hires are up. And importantly, the attainment gap has narrowed slightly.
Willie Rennie.
Before giving way, you'd think there's nothing wrong with Scottish education with how she's started off her contribution this afternoon. Does she not reflect on the fact, just take one example, the massive shortage of STEM teachers that feeds right into vocational education and training? They should not recognise that that's a real problem in our education system.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I unsurprisingly have begun with what there is to celebrate in Scottish education, and there is a great deal to celebrate in Scottish education, and I hope we could all take the opportunity to actually do a little bit of that today, Presiding Officer. But as well, as Mr Rennie raises, there is a challenge. It's not unique to Scotland, but there is a challenge. But we do see STEM teacher numbers at its highest level since 2011, and of course we have more to do to ensure, for example, through the STEM bursaries, that we can continue to encourage young people and indeed those already in a career to take up STEM teaching. But we also see, Presiding Officer, a record number of full-time first degree entrants to university coming from the most deprived areas. A strong record in education is further underlined by the fact that Scotland ranked fourth in the recent 2018 PISA study of global competence. Given that record number of school leavers are going to work, training or further study, tells me that Curriculum for Excellence is preparing learners well for their futures. Indeed, Curriculum for Excellence has been endorsed by independent international experts, the OECD, with Dr. Beatrice Pong quoted as saying that Curriculum for Excellence has expanded the opportunities for Scottish learners to thrive.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. And indeed, she may not want to take Willie Rennie's criticisms, but the OECD themselves said that there needs to be further integration with vocational qualifications and curriculum for excellence. So rather than just trotting out the lines on what she thinks is going well, would she accept that that's an area where we need to improve on in terms of curriculum for excellence in Scottish education?
Cabinet Secretary, give you the time back.
Well, the member raises a very important point about what the OECD has said about encouraging us to look to reform. That's exactly why one of the first things I did when appointed as Cabinet Secretary for Education was to develop the education reform process, which is just about to report in many ways, particularly the Louise Hayward work, which is a specific example of trying to take on some of the challenges that Daniel Johnston has quite rightly raised. So I will make no apologies, Presiding Officer, for coming to this chamber and celebrating what is good within Scottish education. I wish more people did the same, Presiding Officer. But I think the record also, as my time at Cabinet Secretary, has shown that I am ready to reform and ready to take those tough decisions, and I hope members across the chamber will support us when we actually see those reform reports being published. If the member will allow, I'll make a little bit more progress. Importantly, in this context of this debate, it is encouraging to see how many learners have taken advantage of the breadth of choice now available in the senior phase, reflected in the fact that the proportion of school leavers gaining vocational and technical qualifications, SCQF level 5 and above, has gone up again. That's 20 percentage points higher than in 2013-14. And let's be clear, this diversification of learner pathways and qualifications is not at the expense of achievement in relation to national qualifications. Last year, we saw one of the strongest ever set of qualification results in an exam year. So, as I've said on a number of occasions now already, Presiding Officer, Scottish education has strong foundations. However, this government is ambitious to see real transformational change that will ensure that all learners have the opportunity to undertake courses that best match their abilities and aspirations and offer a sound footing for their route through and beyond secondary school. The world around us has changed beyond recognition over the last few years, and our learners and those who support them deserve a system which listens to them and their needs and is flexible and adaptable to change. This is why I've committed to an ambitious education reform programme which is ongoing and is starting now to demonstrate in a number of ways how we are putting learners at the centre of all that we do. I'm looking forward to the publication of the vision for Scottish education following the national discussion which took place last year. This provides us an opportunity to establish a 20-year vision for education in Scotland, which can drive decision-making right across the system. Members across the chamber should have confidence in what comes from the national discussion because it has children and young people at its heart. It was, of course, jointly convened with COSLA, independently facilitated by Professors Carol Campbell and Alma Harmis, and received over 5,700 responses. The National Discussions publication in the spring will produce a vision for the future, a unifying vision against which we will test all further reform. It will provide an opportunity for Scotland as a nation to be very clear about the purpose of education. This is not just the Scottish Government's vision, and it provides the opportunity for everyone involved in Scottish education to start the next chapter with a clear and shared goal. And everyone absolutely will always include Fergus Ewan, and I'll give way to the member.
Fergus Ewan.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you so much for not forgetting about me. Could I just raise an issue that was raised with me yesterday by Chris Dowling, who's the coordinator of the Developing Young Workforce programme in Highland, and who are responsible through Inverness Chamber for employing 20 school coordinators. Their contracts are on a year-to-year basis. The year is up at the end of this month. They haven't had notice of their capital allocation. I know that Sandy Begbie and Joe Griffin are working hard on this, as are other officials, but can the Cabinet Secretary look into getting that information out? Because a year-to-year means you've got no job security, you can't get a mortgage, you're inclined to go for another job, and you're not able, really, to give your full contribution to it.
Cabinet Secretary, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I believe the Minister has met and discussed the issue, but I can assure you it's also something which I am unaware of, and we're very keen to make sure that those who work very hard within the developing young workforce have that reassurance that we can possibly give them at this time. So I give my assurance to the member that is very much already on my radar. Presiding Officer, if I can now move to the work that Professor Louise Hayward and her ongoing independent review into qualifications and assessments has been doing. I'm very supportive of that review's vision to create an inclusive and a highly regarded qualifications and assessment system that inspires learning, values diversity of achievements and supports all learners into the next phase of their lives, socially, culturally and economically. I very much welcome the significant levels of engagement in that review, but particularly for learners as well. We've also heard the very strong voices from higher education, further education and industry, which are also critically important to ensuring that any future decisions will create a qualification system that both recognise and value right across further education, higher education and through employers. And I am very clear that we need to find a way of making parity of esteem between vocational and technical and national qualifications a reality so that Scotland can adapt to meet new global challenges. We also, of course, have the Skills Delivery Review led by James Withers, which is also very relevant in this context. We know that we need to, right across the country, prepare learners to gain skills to better prepare them for their futures, and the skills landscape is very important in that. Vocational and technical qualifications also provide learners with important practical skills, as well as the knowledge of the world of work, important experience and a chance to develop the attributes that we know employers value greatly. In fact, the most recent Scottish Employers Perspectives survey in 2021 found that the majority of employers found school leavers to be well or very well prepared for the world of work. And we see the benefits of our significant investment in young people through developing the young workforce and also the young person's guarantee. Scotland has higher employment rates and lower unemployment rates of 16 to 24-year-olds than the rest of the UK. Now, the Minister for Higher Education, Further Education and Youth Employment and Training, in closing this debate, will share more with you about what we've done with school-college partnerships, foundation apprenticeships and other elements of developing the Young Workforce Programme to transform work-related learning and enable the significant expansion of a range of vocational and technical courses that we have. We have also ensured that the Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework Partnership continues to be supported, as they have a very important role in this. There is also an important role, Presiding Officer, in awards that are seen, such as Youth Scotland Youth Achievement Awards, the Saltire Awards, the Duke of Edinburgh Awards, Young STEM Leader Awards and so on. These are important recognitions of further work that goes on in our schools. And I mentioned but one example, if I can, Presiding Officer, of Barhead High School in East Renfrewshire, which has greatly expanded its curriculum. And in the last 2 years, 100% of Barhead High School's leavers have progressed into employment, further or higher education training or another positive step, and I pay credit to the work that they have done and other schools do across the country. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, it has been, I hope, today a real opportunity for us, yes, to celebrate what we can do in Scottish education, yes, to see what the challenges are, but also to acknowledge and celebrate the real progress that has been made and expanding vocational and technical qualifications on offer in Scotland's schools. Of course we can go further, of course there is more to do, but if we deliver and we implement on our education reform agenda, we will do just that. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Stephen Kerr to speak to and move Amendment 8291.2 for around 9 minutes. Mr Kerr.
I move the amendment in my name. These past few weeks have been chaotic for the SNP. The veil of pretense of the last couple of decades has been ripped away, and it's been like that scene in The Wizard of Oz when all is revealed and the people of Scotland are left saying, "We can see you." And a week from now, we will have a new leader of the SNP. So this could very well be the last time I have the pleasure of speaking in a debate opposing Shirley-Ann Somerville in her role as Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills. Who knows? We've had our differences, and whilst she is a political opponent, she is not and has never been my enemy. And so regardless of what transpires next week, I in all sincerity offer my best wishes to her personally. And extending this conciliatory tone, I'm pleased to say that there's a great deal of consensus that can be struck around this important subject we're debating if we push aside the usual dollop of hubris in the government motion and in the Cabinet Secretary's speech. We will support the government motion tonight and the Labour amendment, and I hope the government will support both of the amendments, because Scotland flourishes when the opportunities of our young people are maximised. For their futures, and for all of our futures, we need to address the significant challenges facing our nation. The need for better productivity, the need for skills to take advantage of automation, artificial intelligence, the transition to net zero, and an increasingly volatile global situation. It is why, Presiding Officer, that we should look at the choice, attainment and positive destinations, exploring the impact of curriculum policy change on young people report, published recently by Stirling University and the Nuffield Foundation, because it speaks to a need to ensure that Scotland's young people get the broadest possible general education covering the broadest possible range of subjects. We can't afford to narrow their choices, because we need the talent of every single child regardless. And that's why the shortages, as highlighted already, the shortages of science, technology, engineering and mathematics teachers must be addressed, and why we need to do everything we can to attract people with specialist skill sets into the teaching profession. We need inspirational teachers, teachers to lift the gaze of our young people and show them a world of possibilities. Now, the Scottish Government Social Research Report, The Impact of Scotland's Developing the Young Workforce Strategy on Education, which was published last week, speaks well on the need to move beyond the attainment of qualifications and focus on meta-skills. Now, a big part of my leadership role in business before I was elected to public office was about building talent. It's about recruitment and retention of talented people. And employers are always on the lookout for people with skills in team working, group leadership, thinking outside of the box, and problem solving. And there is a real cost to business when they can't recruit skilled people. There's a cost to recruit. There's the cost of recruitment itself, but there's also the opportunity cost of lost productivity down to poorly skilled workers and missed business opportunities. We need businesses engaged in our schools. That's clear. And we do our young people a grave disservice when we fail to properly expose them to the real world of work. We fail them because we don't allow them to see the vast possibilities that exist for them. We fail them when we don't help them understand the world of work is crying out for people who have their talents and skills and passions. That is why we need to expose our children and young people to the world of work. And I can't see why we can't do that from the earliest years. Play is a very effective way to make that introduction. We can give our young people a vision of their possibilities and reinforce that vision by bringing them into contact with a whole variety of businesses, sectors, roles and careers choices throughout their years of broad general education, and then help them to be personally equipped with the confidence and the resilience and the skill sets they need to take advantage of the opportunities that exist. Businesses can and must make that investment in our classrooms. No doubt, it's in their best interests to do it. But we must be sure that when businesses make the investment, when they prepare to provide support, that they don't come up against a brick wall, that there aren't barriers to getting into the school. And while there are examples of schools opening their doors to the local business community and interacting with all kinds of businesses and organisations, there are also places where none of this happens, and that must change. There cannot be a postcode lottery in matters as important as these. The social research paper finds that a barrier to curriculum-based work-related learning is that teachers feel overburdened as it is, and that they lack the confidence and the resources that they need to build work-related learning into their lessons. So we need to support our teachers to help them make this possible, because this is the kind of innovative approach that shows what Scotland's educational experience should be. It needs more support. It needs to be rolled out across our nation so that all of Scotland's young people can benefit. We need wider recognition of the importance of sound career guidance from S3 onwards. And I welcome the work that's being done in this area, but I want us to go further. We also need to recognise the importance of personal mentoring, especially in the senior phase. This shouldn't be a tick-box exercise. We should draw on all available talent from across the community, from businesses, professional bodies and organisations in the area. And I have nothing but praise for all those already mentoring young people across Scotland, very often in a voluntary capacity. Let's over-invest in helping young people, see that their options are what their options are, and helping them get to the places they want to get to. We will all be winners when we help them to win. But there is a disparity that is holding us back. Traditional ingrained attitudes towards technical subjects and technical and professional qualifications are holding us back. Too many people still believe, that there is a best pathway for a child, and that pathway involves passing hires, advanced hires, and going to university. And for some young people, that is the best path for them. But there are other paths, and those paths are just as good.
Emma Harper.
Wow, thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Stephen Kerr, for giving away. What you're talking about is just making me think about what's happening locally in Dumfries and Galloway, where businesses are engaging with schools. Jaspie Wilson and Dalbeattie is one of them. And the kids are being valued for choosing whatever path they want, which might not be uni, it might be the vocational skills. So would you agree that actually there is work being done out there that is talking about exactly what you've been on your feet going
through
on
the chair,
the last
please,
few
Ms.
minutes? Thank you. Apologies, Presiding Officer.
Stephen Kerr, and I give you the time back.
Thank you. Emma Harper is right. There is indeed some really good work going on, but it's not equally distributed across Scotland. And there are gaps. And those gaps should be a priority to fill. Possible educational experience. I would say, Deputy Presiding Officer, that as long as we... I'll just do this one last point and then come to you. As long as we hold on to these old, out-of-date ideas about the value of different pathways available to young people, we are going to hold ourselves as an economy and as a society. Stuart McMillan first.
Stuart McMillan.
Stephen Kerr for taking the intervention. And similar to what my colleague Emma Harper just said, when I notice it in Inverclyde, it's obviously my party don't control Inverclyde, but there is a lot of great work taking place. So can Stephen Kerr actually name the local authority areas where there's a problem that he would like to see fixed?
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I'm not going to do that for obvious reasons. That's not the purpose. I don't think that's a very good use of my time and speech, but I give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
In the spirit of consensus, just in case is our last debate, Presiding Officer, can I welcome Stephen Kerr's remarks on this, and can I encourage him, if he has not done so already, to read the interim report by Professor Louise Hayward, which is very much trying to get to how we not just see one right or successful way through school, but there's a myriad of ways we can do that, and we must reform to be able to capture that in its widest sense.
Stephen Kerr, if
I agree
you
with
bring
the Cabinet
your
Secretary.
Remarks to a conclusion shortly.
I agree with the Cabinet Secretary in respect to Louise Hayward's work. I look forward to the full report when it comes out, I think, in May, and I look forward to that very much. So, as I bring my remarks to a conclusion, I would like to challenge the Government. If the Government truly wants to ensure parity of esteem, and I think we all do, then it does have to start with parity of funding. We should be fully funding our young people's choices, whether they go to university, college, or into an apprenticeship. And this would go a long way to address the funding issues that our colleges have. That is the real world, and I hope that the Minister responding will not seek to deny there is a financial challenge. But what I'm doing today is making an appeal to social justice and the common good, because this is about equality of opportunity. That's what's needed, regardless of who you are, Deputy Presiding Officer, what your background is, which postcode you live in. You can achieve what you want. You can be what you want to be. You can do what you want to do. That is what being a young Scot should mean. That is the philosophy on these benches. And we will support all measures to make that a reality for every young person in Scotland. When we invest in our young people, we invest in the future of our nation. To have a Scottish education system worthy of its heritage, worthy of the young people it serves, then we must build a system of education which offers diverse opportunities for young people to engage with work, with different ways of learning, and with the possibilities that the future holds. I urge all members to support the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call on Michael Mana to speak to and move Amendment 8291.1. Around 7 minutes, Mr Mana.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'd hope to start the speech today with some observations on the various candidates for First Minister's positions on education. So we tuned in on YouTube. Unfortunately, they had absolutely nothing to say about education whatsoever. So we turned over to the new Luther film, which was slightly less aggressive instead. But I'd say that Scottish Labour is always happy to debate the educational needs of our young people and the skills they need to succeed in our future economy and to build Scotland's future. And to be frank, this government motion does provide an extremely narrow picture of what is happening in our schools, our colleges and our workplaces, and too narrow, in my view, to be deemed appropriate, representative or in many areas responsible. Rather opening up choice and opportunity, this government has waged a 15-year campaign to collapse choice and opportunity. And the recent report from the University of Stirling and the Nuffield Foundation, Choice, Attainment and Positive Destinations, lays that bare. The impact of the policy choices made by this government over 15 years. Botched curriculum design and implementation, failure to recruit teachers in core subject areas, stripping out huge amounts of resources. And as ever, the consequences weigh most heavily on the poorest. Options may exist in theory, but for far too many, they are not real. And let me tell you how. At the start of 2021, government data showed that an average S5 pupil in Dundee was enrolled in 3.5 subjects, which was an entire subject less than in 2014. In Braeview Academy, that was an average of 2.5 subjects, among the lowest in the whole of Scotland. Just down the road, at the far more affluent Grove Academy, 4 subjects. That's the real story of options available to young people in Scotland today. Certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member for allowing the intervention. The Nuffield Presley report is a very important report, and I've enjoyed my time speaking to Professor Peatley on it. But can the member also recognise that what it's talking about is national qualifications, which actually doesn't include much of what we're talking about today, and the wider aspects that are now available within our schools? The whole entire point of it is to actually ensure that we are celebrating those as well as the national qualifications. They are equally as important.
Michael Mara.
So I would say to the Cabinet Secretary that in the same year, in 2021, at SCQF Level 5, just one candidate achieved the qualification in engineering practice, which he is talking about. 46 in construction skills, 250 in cybersecurity. Compare that to 44,000 candidates for English. If the Cabinet Secretary really thinks that's a significant broadening of the choice and availability and options being taken by young people, I'm really flabbergasted by it. Because when we consider the rapid and accelerating change in our economy and in wider society, the stakes cannot be higher in this area. Challenges posed by climate change, demographic change and technological change, ubiquitous innovations in AI and machine learning. It's clear we urgently need to strengthen those key areas, workforce with skills and qualifications in STEM subjects. And those qualifications are notionally available in those areas that I've just outlined, but in reality, they are far too limited. And the untapped potential of young people in such vital areas as these should kickstart meaningful action from the government immediately if we're to avert a national skills shortage, which will threaten the future, no thank you, not in the moment, our future economic viability. And Audit Scotland was abundantly clear in the damning report on planning for skills in January 2022 on this issue. Responsibility for setting a direction lies with government ministers, and they have utterly failed to do so. Ministers did not provide the necessary leadership for progress. Those are Audit Scotland's words. And despite a commitment to improve skills planning in 2017, clearly articulate to Skills Development Scotland, the Scottish Funding Council, what it expects of them in working together to implement skills alignment, ministers are also failing abjectly to provide any vision, strategy or guidance. And they do so also to the future of our colleges. So many of the qualifications that we're talking about today and that are hailed in the government motion are taught and awarded in partnership with our further education sector. And yet time and time again, we see ministers proving to be incapable of providing adequate funding or strategic direction to the college sector. The Scottish Funding Council's Coherence and Sustainability Review of Tertiary Education, published in 2021, called for a clear, strategic, long-term vision and intent for the future of tertiary education, one which responds better to current and future needs of pupils, students, employers and broader economic and social drivers. In response, this government said it welcomed it and broadly accepted the review recommendations. So that became another review, now Practice and Principles, still years on, unpublished. And colleges are awaiting the light at the end of the tunnel in the hope, Presiding Officer, the hope that it's not a speeding train in the form of yet more savage cuts from this government. And there is an unfolding college funding crisis today, with no money for agreed pay awards, voluntary severance schemes being opened across the country and underpinned by the real threat of compulsory redundancy, certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
For taking another intervention. I'm just wondering, during the budget process, when the Labour Party actually came forward with fully costed proposals and alternatives for this, or is this just a little bit more hot air from the Labour Party benches and nothing constructive when it mattered during the budget process?
Michael Marr, I can give you the time back for the interview.
Thank you, President. I certainly think on this point, on the budget, we've had plenty of hot air from the government. We've had, quick to trumpet, £26 million of additional funding to the college sector in the 2023-24 budget. Yet months later, it's completely unclear to the Scottish Funding Council and to colleges what the purpose of the funding is. Mm. It's been referred to as transition funding, but no one has determined, Presiding Officer, what colleges are supposed to be transitioning to. So I've asked the Minister. He said to ask the SFC. I asked the SFC. They said to ask the Minister. It's a shambles of indecision, dither and hopeless delay. No thank you. And you can perhaps address this in your closing speech, because the absence of any strategic direction from this government, and without guarantee the £26 million will become core funding, colleges are taking difficult financial decisions with no idea whether they are the right ones. I hope he does answer those questions today, because the numerous opportunities, Presiding Officer, the Minister has had in this chamber and committee have been clear. Without swift, decisive action, it will soon be difficult for our young people to benefit from school-college partnerships at all. Scotland's young people need a government willing to face up to the current challenges in our education system, prepared to do the hard work and prepared to engage in genuine reform. That's the change Scotland needs.
Thank you, Samara. I now call on Willie Rennie for around 6 minutes, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think it's important to recognise when education is making progress. In fact, I go to schools almost every single week and I commend teachers and pupils for the work that they do. But this place, I think, is about driving improvement. It's not just about self-congratulation. It shouldn't just be filled with speeches, as I'm sure we'll hear later on, of a list of massive achievements, when there are clearly significant challenges that need to be addressed. This motion today and the debate so far has been self-congratulatory, and the superficially attractive increase in the numbers taking part in the foundation apprenticeships and other routes is positive. But the OECD were very critical that the Scottish Government had hardly any substantial data on destinations, on the value that young people feel about these courses, about the value that employers perhaps feel or don't feel about these courses, and whether there is a uniform offer across the country, particularly in rural areas, perhaps in areas that don't have a local college, where Michael Marr has quite rightly identified the big differences between school to school in terms of the range of subjects being taken and the pitiful number sometimes that young people are taking up these options. We have no real data on any of that, and we need to have a far more substantial body of evidence before we can spend time in this chamber congratulating ourselves about how successful we have been. The Chartered Institute for Personal Development have been very striking in their criticisms of the approach so far. They highlight that employers feel that young people who come from school are poorly prepared for work. That has been a story that's been lasted through the generations, but we seem to be incapable of addressing the substantial issue. There is big gaps in recruitment, and there is an imbalance between graduates and those taking alternative routes for education. We have a significant number of people who are graduates who are underemployed. They are not employed in areas that their education and training would help them achieve. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Minister.
Mr Rennie mentioned the CIPD report in terms of employer perspective on the readiness of pupils for the world of work, but would he also reflect on the Scottish Employer Perspective Survey from 2021, which said the opposite, that a majority of them found that they were ready for work?
Willie Rennie, I can give you the time back.
So this is exactly the point. We have a substantial body, the Chartered Institute for Personal Development, who have highlighted through evidence that there is a challenge. And the Minister, instead of addressing that issue, comes up with some counter-evidence that he believes knocks down the Chartered Institute for Personal Development. I think it's important to recognise the challenges that we face in Scottish education, and we address that problem substantially rather than just dismissing the evidence that's put forward by our authoritative body. No, not just now. So if you look at the Construction Industry Training Board, they highlight the lack of parity of esteem. Even within those who are taking these alternative routes, the foundation apprenticeships, between construction and other qualifications. Now, how on earth can we get to the position we're going to meet the challenges that we face in terms of net zero if we don't have a parity of esteem, even within those who are taking foundation apprenticeships, that they are not available, they're not available in all schools, and there are pitiful numbers, very small numbers, who are taking up these options in schools. If you look at the numbers that they reckon that we need, not just now, Ferguson, I'll come back in a second, the extra workers that the construction industry reckon that we require is 19,550. They recognise that there's going to have to be 22,500 people who are trained and new roles supplied in order to meet the net zero obligations. This is an enormous number, but yet so few are taking it up in school. I'll take Fergus Ewan now.
Fergus Ewan.
Mr Rennie rightly mentions the importance of preparing young people for the workforce. Does he agree with me, and not to disappoint colleagues around the chamber for failing to raise this matter, presiding officer, that one way to prepare people for work of all sorts is to endow them with the skills of learning how to touch type and communicate clearly, precisely, swiftly and effectively? And moreover, it's an incredibly inexpensive thing to do and an enormous legacy that we could give to our children for the future.
Willie Rennie. And I can give you the time back.
We do miss Fergus Ewing on the Education Committee with these incisive questions about touch typing. I'm sure the world will hear his plea and will respond appropriately. But there are powerful forces at play here. We know that we've been trying to get people to not go down the traditional, you would call the academic route, for a number of years. And we've failed, really, for a number of different reasons. There is significant peer pressure within schools, societal pressure, family pressure, in order to aspire to do better. You don't succeed, apparently, unless you go to university. Pupil choice is an important factor, however, as well. We need to make sure that young people have got the choices that are available to meet their needs. But, of course, the economic needs as well, and I've already highlighted the mismatch between those we are training and the needs of the economy. But we clearly need capacity in the system as well. Far too few schools have qualified staff who are able to deliver these courses. Sometimes they don't have a local college that they can tap into in terms of the school-college partnerships. They might not have the equipment available, and the guidelines are not clear either. And then, of course, we have the shortage of STEM teachers, which is getting to a crisis point now, as we saw last week with the uptake of young trainee teachers.
Mr. Rennie, I think you're bringing your remarks to a conclusion.
Yeah. Mr. Kerr, I will not be able to take the intervention. But in terms of solutions, I think Louise Hayward's parity of STEAM options is a potential positive way forward. I think the careers review is a welcome step to have that comprehensive approach to careers, including work experience. I think that will help. We do need to get some clarity for the colleges. I don't know why we're taking so long to give them clear direction with the purpose and principles approach. We've been dithering for ages. Likewise, with the skills alignment. We should be looking over to countries like Germany, where they've got, through their economic strength, a great partnership between industry and the state to make sure they've got a fantastic offer on vocational. Those are the things that we should be looking to. And we should certainly not be complacent, and we certainly shouldn't fill this chamber with congratulatory speeches.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I can advise the chamber we've got a little bit of time in hand, so anybody taking an intervention should get the time back. I call first Cocab Stewart to be followed by Pam Gosell for around 6 minutes. Ms Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for bringing this debate today. Hailed among the pioneers of the 21st century learning, Scotland's Curriculum for Excellence was designed in the wake of extensive public debate, which I remember well as we came towards the end of 5 to 14 curriculum. The aim of providing a holistic approach to education that would equip our young people with the skills needed to flourish in a rapidly changing world. And as a teacher, I've often felt and been told that the immense benefits of practical training and skills-based courses are too easily overlooked. A sentiment echoed by Professor Ken Muir in his 2022 report, Putting Learners at the Centre. According to college students that were referenced in this report, some vocational routes, such as the Duke of Edinburgh, were viewed as being for the misbehaving kids and not valued or seen as important, as, for example, Master English. If you weren't taking an exam, then you're looked down upon. Now, these perceptions are changing. Our youngsters are being nurtured and developed as a result of a carefully constructed system that takes into account the incredible range of talent we see in our schools, offering opportunities for qualifications across a wide variety of sectors, from financial services, engineering, digital marketing, event management, and hospitality. And there are many courses that are available that are industry-tailored to prepare students for a successful future in the workforce. Now, these routes are really important as part of a wider measure to address areas experiencing skills and workforce shortages, which my colleagues from across the chamber have mentioned. Ensuring the provision of such courses is also essential to the Scottish Government's long-standing commitment to promoting inclusivity and assisting those most in need, as reflected in their Developing the Young Workforce strategy. Now, Gordon Stobart has highlighted that Scotland's inclusive practices were demonstrated by its early move away from selective to comprehensive schools, meaning a typical classroom will enjoy, and I did enjoy, having students from a variety of cultural, social, economic backgrounds, as well as a broad spectrum of interests and attainments. So the use of varied formats is key to serving a more diverse student body. And having worked in education previously, I wholeheartedly agree that offering greater choice and learning flexibility remains one of the key effective ways of boosting attainment and reducing wider inequalities. We know and have heard today that a record number of people were in work, training, further study or leaving school in 2022. And I want to pay particular tribute to two schools in my own constituency of Glasgow Kelving. The Glasgow Gaelic School and Hindland Secondary School, both of which achieved 100% positive destinations for senior phase pupils. The Glasgow Gaelic School offers several options for their learners, which start in S4 with part-time placements, working with their three partner colleges. They are also supported by developing the Young Force, Workforce Colleagues, Skills Development Scotland, and I also hear from the teachers that there's a great career advisor there as well. The school cites one reason for such achievement on such positive destinations comes from knowing their children and their families and being able to work with them to get the best outcome for each and every one of them as an individual. And I'd like to put on record my thanks to a strong staff team there at Senior Phase, led by the Deputy Head, Miss Julie McNeil. A fantastic achievement and accomplishment indeed. and a testament to the hard work of pupils and staff following what has been an incredibly difficult and unsettling time. This is not self-congratulatory. This is acknowledging fully and wholeheartedly the hard work of all our teachers that is going on and being cited by my colleagues. I will give way.
Stephen Kerr.
It's not self-congratulation, CoCab Stewart says, so I'm looking forward to hearing where she feels that we need to do much better, as has been highlighted by a number of speakers in this debate so far.
CoCab Stewart.
I thank Mr Kerr, and I do come on to suggestions that I am happy to push for as well. Mm-hmm. Of course, there remains much work to be done. And I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's ambition to continually advance and reform our education programme, as demonstrated by the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessments in Scotland, which began last year. The Hayward Review is primarily focused on ensuring those between 15 and 18 have an enhanced and equal opportunity to demonstrate the breadth and depth and relevance of their learning, and aim to provide a new model of qualifications and assessments that is fit for the 21st century. Now, the interim report suggests that a better and more clearly defined integration of academic and vocational qualifications be required, with very careful consideration of the language around course descriptors. And I believe that if that is adopted, this could go some way towards addressing the challenges that are associated with outdated perceptions and move towards the quest for parity of esteem, as referred to by Ken Muir's report, between vocational and academic courses. I am glad to hear the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to ensure that parity of esteem for all our learners, qualifications and achievement be at the heart of reforms. We must progress from just valuing what we measure and data to actually measuring what we value. And, Presiding Officer, we absolutely value our learners and all that they bring, not only to our economy, but also to our society and our culture. And I look forward to hearing the progress that has been made on that. In closing, I encourage the Scottish Government to continue to take the pragmatic steps to ensure that all our young people explore and develop their own curiosity, their hopes, skills, interests, and ultimately find a pathway into employment that works best for them.
Thank you, Ms. I now call Pam Gosell, to be followed by Ruth Maguire in 6 minutes. Ms. Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a huge advocate for the expansion of technical and professional qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools, I am delighted to be contributing to this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Schemes like developing the young workforce show the considerable merits offered to young people through work-based learning. Nearly all employers in the DYW evaluation emphasised the importance of the development of soft skills that create adaptive learners. These skills create added value for both learners and employers. And so I think we are all in agreement today that this expansion is something that needs to happen. It's just about how we get there. In the Government's own motion, they refer to the close partnership working between schools and colleges in delivering vocational learning and the subsequent pathways into jobs. But this comes from the same SNP Government that is cutting college funding in real terms. Colleges, unfortunately, still await detail of how they might deploy the non-recurrent £26 million announced in the budget. But we have all seen reports of the colleges undertaking voluntary redundancy programmes. And with fewer lectures comes fewer classes. Therefore, I hope the Scottish Government... If I can just finish this off there, I'll come back to you. Yeah. Therefore, I hope that the Scottish Government will outline how they expect levels of schools and colleges activity to be sustained in this current environment. They should also confirm their position on colleges undertaking compulsory redundancies programmes, because unfortunately this is likely the next step given that the financial and funding pressures that colleges are facing.
Bob Doran.
Thank the member for giving way, and in my contribution I'll talk about the financial challenges of colleges as well, I should say to the member. But can the member tell me, did the Conservatives propose any additional cash for colleges during the recent budget? If so, how much, and where was the money coming from? Or else it could just be hollow rhetoric here this afternoon.
Pam Gosell.
I thank the member for his intervention. I think it's very clear what I was speaking about was the £26 million that you can't even provide direction for the money you're actually even giving. And I think that was something my colleague Michael Mara mentioned as well, that it's important that even if you're just giving that money, give some direction to the £26 million. So when you're talking about budgets, let's just look for even direction in the money you've just given, never mind the money that is needed and the big gap in colleges, that colleges are speaking directly to me and I'm sure directly to the Cabinet Secretary and Minister as well. Like Scotland's colleges, employers are fundamental to the delivery of technical and professional qualifications. Many simply do not have the administrative capacity to wade through the hordes of red tape, nor the financial leeway to incur the costs associated. One large employer in Glasgow said, "It's very heavy admin and not easy to navigate. There are so many hoops to jump through to get funding. In addition to this, the demand for work-based learning and apprenticeships is significantly outpacing SNP government's funding. The Scottish Training Federation and the Construction Industry Training Board are calling for more apprenticeship places. So the onus is now on the SNP to act by increasing apprenticeship."
It's not working. I think it is now.
The Scottish Training Federation and the Construction Industry Training Board are calling for more apprenticeship places. So the onus is now on the SNP to act by increasing apprenticeship places. This is particularly important if we want to see all young people offered the same opportunities. One aspect that I wish to draw the Parliament's attention to is the need to support employers. To need to support employers to provide opportunities for all young people, including those with additional support needs. While this can represent a challenge for both the young person involved and the employer, it can make a true difference in the learner's future. I was also pleased that the parity of esteem for all post-school pathways was mentioned in today's motion. Exposing pupils to a range of pathways is vital to ensuring no young person is left behind. Last year, when I read the CIPD report on overqualifications, I was not surprised that the pupils felt career services frequently pushed the higher education narrative. With more than half not having been exposed to apprenticeship opportunities, and I'd like to, presiding officer, give a quick example of a real-life personal example for my son. My son basically was at school a couple of years ago, and he was missing school. He wasn't enjoying school and he felt that the school wasn't listening to him. He felt that he didn't know where he was going. He left school to go to college without knowing his direction where he was going, and he didn't have those pathways explained to him individually for what he was looking for. And then when he went to college, after a year, he wanted to drop out. He said the words, "I thought college was hands-on learning." And only then did I, as a mother, understand that he's looking for an apprenticeship. And when I spoke to him, he was very happy to go and down the route. He wanted an apprenticeship. And when looking at apprenticeships, I offered to help him. My son went out and got his own apprenticeship, wakes up at 5 a.m. in the morning, takes 3 trains over to his apprenticeship, and really, really enjoys it and absolutely loves it. The fact he's doing mechanical engineering, you know, and he talks about it with such passion. That's what he wanted to do. But my child would have been like many other children and students out there that get left behind because the pathway is not tailored to them. So I'm really hoping, presiding officer, that today the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister listen to this. It's a personal example I'm giving, but as many examples out there I've heard from other people as well. Therefore, I would like to urge the Scottish Government to work with Skills Development Scotland and developing the young workforce to expose young people to alternative pathways, as I've just said. In conclusion, presiding officer, the economy has been stagnating for some time in Scotland. And if we want to build a truly dynamic economy, we can no longer accept the status quo. Change requires exposure to technical and professional qualifications weaved throughout the young person's learning journey, a reformed career service tailored uniquely to the needs of a child, more collaboration between further and higher education, as well as the removal of barriers that prevent employers from taking on young people.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gosol. We have now used up a lot of the time we had in hand, so any interventions will need to be brief and may not be able to be recompensed entirely. With that, I call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Carol Mochan, around 6 minutes, Ms. Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is a pleasure to speak to the Government's motion today and recognise the success of the education system in Scotland, not for self-congratulation, but in gratitude to teachers, staff, pupils, their parents and families. It's a fact that a record number of our young people are now in work, training or further study after leaving school. 95.7% of school leavers in 2021-2022 were progressing their studies or careers within 3 months. A demonstrable success, which we must now build on and strengthen. In preparing for today's debate, I had a wee look back at previous times we've debated vocational and technical qualifications. In 2018, which was the year of the young people, I welcomed the fact that the headline target of the strategy to reduce youth unemployment by 40% in 2021 had been met 4 years early. At that point, I noted that although the broad target was met, there was still a bit of work to do on addressing gender imbalance and on improving opportunities and outcomes among particular groups, such as those who are disabled, care experienced, or from minority ethnic backgrounds. I'd like to focus my remarks on that today. I was pleased to hear confirmation last week from the First Minister in her answer to my Education Committee colleague Graham Day that there has been improvements made in attracting disabled young people to apprenticeships, with figures showing that significant progress had been made. Skills development needs enhanced funding contributions for disabled apprentices in training until the age of 29. The most recent statistics, published by SES on the 14th of February, report that the disability rate for modern apprenticeships starts by the end of quarter three was 14.8%, 2 percentage points higher than the quarter three of the previous year. Just under 3,000 individuals had known disability status or self-identified impairment, health condition or learning difficulty, which was an increase on the same point last year. It is good, particularly for the individuals that are partaking of the apprenticeships, but there is still a lot more work to be done. I hope that with continued strong partnership working between employers, schools and universities, supported by the Developing the Young Workforce groups, that will continue. I have highlighted this example before, but I'll make no apology for doing it again, as it does illustrate well that sort of joint working, and I think Stephen Kerr will appreciate this one. Martin and Son Builders are a small family business in Kilwinning. The owner of the business, Martin, is profoundly deaf after losing his hearing 5 years ago. And one of the reasons why he was keen to be involved with developing the young workforce Ayrshire was to demonstrate to pupils that it's not stopped him from running a successful business. Martin visited St Winning's Primary School for 5 consecutive days to give each of the 5 classes an insight into the building trade. Pupils participated in a series of interactive tasks, including using laser levels, sizing, measuring angles, and calculating thermal heat loss. The young people were also introduced to bricklaying and watched a live demonstration of a small wall being erected. As well as introducing the pupils to this career area and allowing them the opportunity to engage in interesting hands-on activity, Martin sent a powerful message to those young people about overcoming challenges and achieving success. The Education Committee has been looking at the experience of disabled children and young people, and particularly their transitions, as part of our scrutiny of Pam Duncan Glancy's Private Members Bill. At a recent visit to Ayrshire College, I heard about what successful project search courses they run in collaboration with partners, one at Cross House Hospital and one at National Trust Scotland Killeen. These courses provide supported learning students with 800 hours of immersion in the facilities of each host business to become work ready. They told me that many students have progressed from the intensive work focus of Project Search to achieve paid employment. For example, at University Hospital Crosshouse, several learners have completed the course and then been successfully employed 16 plus hours a week as domestics, porters and admin assistants on site at the hospital. Other learners have taken up apprenticeship schemes with local authorities in admin, IT and outdoor activities, building on skills first identified during Project Search. Several learners have also gained employment with other employers out with the host organisation. Employment at retail outlets and supermarkets have helped many of their students gain their first paid work and build resilience to eventually increase their working hours. Ayrshire College currently employs a previous Project Search student within its canteen facilities as a cook, and they're delighted that that student has maintained that position for several years. So at a time where a record high number of young people are now in work, training or further study after leaving school, it is appropriate to celebrate that success, but also to be clear that it's time to build on it for all our young people. We need the talent of every single one of them, not just for them to flourish and have a good experience, but for the success of our country. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms McGuire. I now call Carolyn Mochan to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Around 6 minutes, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I say that it was surprising in a month where the government are using parliamentary time trying to spin out as many good news stories as possible that today they have chosen to defend their record on education, particularly vocational and technical qualifications. I think it is fair that other members have indicated there are, you know, good news stories that we can all individually pick out. But I think our job in this place is to look at the broad picture across Scotland and be quite real about what is actually happening for young people. So some more real stories from me. Earlier this month, I met with striking teachers from Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders, who made it clear to us, as their representatives, that the subject choice was narrowing and narrowing quickly. One in attendance actually told me that because subject choice is so limited in rural areas, her sons cannot study the subjects that will allow them to pursue their future, the one that they would wish to do. And so it is her sons who have to adapt rather than the way this government is operating. Scottish Labour, of course, supports the expansion of vocational and technical training, but the reality on the ground in Scotland is that this government is failing to get the basic things right. It is no longer the case that only choice is limited. There is now a limiting of opportunity. Where you live and the background you come from now dictates your future when it comes to your health, your access to public services, and definitely to your education. That, Presiding Officer, is SNP Scotland. That is the record of the last 15 years. Presiding Officer, the importance of the role colleges play in the delivery of vocational and technical training cannot be understated, and others have spoken about that. However, as my colleague has mentioned, there is confusion over how colleges can spend their budget allocation for 2023-24, confusion that again has arisen as a result of a lack of ministerial direction. And it's an important point. Colleges need some direction. They need some leadership. Any progress made on vocational qualifications is undoubtedly put at risk by a lack of direction provided to the college sector from government. And this is a risk Scottish Labour is absolutely not willing to take. And it should be the same for the government ministers, and they should address this. Therefore, like my colleagues, I would encourage the government to reach out to the college sector and provide that clarity quickly. Moving on, Presiding Officer, I would suggest that it may be worthwhile for the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister to consider how the Scottish Government can utilise relations with NES, National Health Service Education Scotland, as Ruth Maguire spoke about in the NHS sector, to ensure more health-related vocational training becomes available to our young people in the senior phase. I appreciate that there are SVQs available in, for example, dental nursing, but the Scottish Government knows it can go further, and it should. Many professions are looking for paths to vocational training, and the skilled team at NES could be a route to pursue this. We are only too well aware of the challenges facing our NHS and social care services in relation to recruitment and retention, perhaps offering more courses that would encourage young people to consider careers in either health or care services would, in the long term, help us to fight those challenges. However, Presiding Officer, I repeat that the delivery of strong vocational and technical training must be widely and importantly equally spread. It cannot be the case that there is a postcode lottery for who vocational and technical training is available to and who it is not. We can, and the point is, we must do better. Presiding Officer, I do not want to contribute to this debate today without mentioning the role of women in STEM and the importance of encouraging women and girls to undertake vocational and technical training linked to STEM. In his recent address to the British Computing Society, the Minister, Jamie Hepburn, himself admitted that the proportion of digital technology roles held by women is less than a quarter, and that a significant pay gap between women and their male counterparts still exists. In fact, if you read the contribution, it is actually shocking, the gap. So while it is absolutely important that we encourage girls in school to study STEM subjects and take up vocational training in this field, we have to also make the future a more attractive one. Entering a male-dominated field where men are paid more is not an attractive option, and so our approach to expanding vocational and technical training must include a multi-layered approach surrounding pay and future opportunities for young girls and women. Only by ensuring that there are equal opportunities in such career paths from the start and throughout will we see parity of esteem between academic and non-academic qualifications. In concluding, Presiding Officer, for too long in Scotland there has been a failure to recognise the importance of vocational qualifications. Others have said this. We must see greater action in this area. The action must surround tackling barriers related to geography, gender and income. It is right to say, and the Cabinet Secretary, of course, was right to say and talk about positive outcomes, but honesty is crucial, absolutely crucial. This is not a time for the Government to stop and pat itself on the back. We have a very, very long way to go, and the challenges facing our education system on this Government's watch are becoming greater. Presiding Officer, genuine reform to the delivery of qualifications would provide opportunities for young people and could provide long-term solutions which address skill shortages in key areas. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Morgan. And I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Sue Webber. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, Presiding Officer, I'd just like to touch upon one point that Stephen Kerr highlighted in his closing remarks, and I quote, he did say, he spoke about the education system as being worthy of its heritage. Now, I will disagree with Mr Kerr on that, because I'm quite sure if we consider many people who have got dyslexia, generation after generation after generation, where the education system in Scotland failed them, then I genuinely cannot accept Mr Kerr's comments about worthy of its heritage. Yeah, absolutely.
Stephen Kerr.
Quick in agree. I agree that the system doesn't always live up to its, you know, in terms of responding to people's needs. I was referring to the worldwide reputation that Scotland's education system has enjoyed for generations, which is where it needs to be now.
Stuart McMillan.
No, absolutely, Mr Kerr. I absolutely agree with you on that point. I know that's what you're talking about and that's what you're referring to. Sorry, Mr Kerr was referring to. However, as I'm a member of the cross-party group on dyslexia, I've got many constituents who have contacted me and I've dealt with over many, many years as a parliamentarian, and the education system failed them generation after generation after generation. So I genuinely think there is a bit of an impression that Scotland's education system in the past was of the highest order. It clearly wasn't when it failed people with dyslexia. So I did want to speak in this debate, as providing a range of technical and vocational opportunities for pupils is something that secondary schools in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency are already offering. Now, before highlighting some local examples, I do think it's important that, as other colleagues from across the chamber have already done, is to mention how vital technical and vocational qualifications are. And they not only provide young people with the opportunity to gain skills through on-the-job training, they are also an instrumental way for businesses to future-proof their workforce. And I think AC White is an outstanding example of how that can be done. AC White is an organisation based in Barrhead, obviously not my constituency, but they, in 2018, they set up a programme with West College Scotland, whereby they offered training opportunities and they also they guaranteed a job at the end of it if the people actually fulfilled the full training. And that particular programme is still ongoing, and I warmly welcome that type of joined-up approach. And also, just yesterday, I met with representatives from Action for Children who are providing support for young people and their families in Inverclyde. across three main areas: criminal justice, employability and also wellbeing. It outlined how, by taking a person-centred approach to employability support and by focusing on developing relationships with young people, they provide a holistic service that delivers better outcomes. And this wraparound service ensures that young people are supported to engage with employability programmes and gain qualifications while completing the unpaid work orders, such as the Construction Skills Certification Scheme card. Now, this is an industry that has in recent years struggled to attract people to the sector, so this shows how the work of Action for Scotland, while primarily being about supporting young people into sustainable employment, can also reap benefits for industry and also the economy. Now, Action for Scotland are also an example of how the third sector can help young people and families caught up in the criminal justice system break that cycle and take a different path. Now, during the meeting, though, the staff highlighted how third sector funding of one-year cycles is a challenge, and they struggle to plan and know what services they can deliver in an area long term, something that Fergus Shewing touched upon in his comments earlier. And I say that the situation is actually comparable to what third sector organisations supporting people with substance misuse issues previously faced. And as we now know, this had cross-party support across the chamber. The Drugs Minister, Angela Constance, MSP, took these concerns on board and delivered multi-year funding opportunities for the third sector working in this area. And as Action for Children work with young people who face many barriers to employment, including in some cases substance dependency, I would like to see the funding models that they rely on, such as No One Left Behind, move to multi-year funding. Now, this would enable the organisation to plan long-term and support more young people in my constituency into sustainable employment through technical and vocational courses. I think the point of breaking the cycle is hugely important, Presiding Officer, because one of the points that was highlighted yesterday was that, irrespective as to the economic situation, it was put to me that 5%, there's a 5% hard-to-reach of young people. There's a 5% hard-to-reach of young people trying to get on to positive outcomes. And when there is an economic downturn, when there's economic challenges, this 5% increases. The situation only gets worse. So if we are to try to get it right to help every single young person, I think organisations like Action for Children and other organisations are hugely important in that. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's motion today touches upon the issue of the developing the young workforce. And I also want to put on record my thanks to their West team for all that they're doing in Inverclyde. The Deputy First Minister came to West College Scotland in 2019 to congratulate four pupils from Inverclyde Academy who, with the help of the DWP, so the DYW West team, they took part in the Green Power Challenge earlier that year. That particular programme helped these young individuals with the technical skills, with vocational skills, also with teamwork, as well as working on their own. Now, these four young men, they've went on, and they're now working in, they're in a positive destination. I was in the school last year, and I did ask the question to see where they were. So I was really pleased to hear that. So here is yet another example of schools, of colleges, and also of other organisations working together in partnership to help our community and also to help our young people. So with that, Presiding Officer, I am conscious I am well over my time, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. And I now call on Sue Webber to be followed by Bob Doris. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Vocational and technical qualifications are vital to the success of the Scottish economy and the levelling up of every part of Scotland. Yet the number of college students has fallen by over 140,000 since the SNP came to power. Under the SNP, funding per college student is over 2,500 lower than funding per university students. The First Minister said she wanted to be judged on her education record, and on that basis, she's failed, particularly with a lack of investment in vocational and technical qualifications. There is no doubting the vital role further education plays in supplying Scotland with the steady flow of skilled people essential for a thriving economy. And it's not just school leavers, but thousands of older people seeking to re-enter the workforce or retrain, something many of us will face in a digital era, which there are no guarantees of a career for life, never mind a job. A full post-pandemic recovery will be impossible without the training offered by Scotland's 26 colleges. Yet at a time when we need more qualified workers than ever, student numbers are decreasing. No one underestimates the scale of the economic challenges we're facing. We've got soaring food and energy costs, but it's not enough to simply expect governments to write even bigger cheques. In the Scottish college sector, the clear message from the experts is that empowering institutions to work more closely with private enterprise could produce better results and limit the pressure on the public purse than if they were solely reliant on taxpayers' money. Flexibility and industry collaboration are crucial, because that is the best way to keep pace with employer demand, especially in digitally driven workplaces where the rate of change is breakneck. Yes, I will.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Is the member aware that colleges are entirely able to drive commercial income and raise it through interaction relations with industry if that's what they want to do?
Sue Webber.
The College Regionalisation Inquiry report that was published today makes reference to the lack of flexibility in funding and is looking for more funding in flexibility for our college sector. And our committee recognised, going back to the report that was published today, the importance for colleges, students and employers to be able to respond effectively to the needs of the local economy. And we believe that it's the responsibility of business and key sectoral bodies to proactively engage with colleges and universities, as this will allow colleges and universities to respond more effectively to help develop the workforce. However, it acknowledges that the challenges that small and medium-sized enterprises can face if they do not have a sectoral body to help set out their skills needs. And the committee recommended that colleges must further develop their engagement with local SMEs to take account of their needs, which are very dynamic and changing across the various sectors. Scottish Apprenticeship Week aims to shine a light on the role apprenticeships play in Scotland and how they affect people, businesses and the economy. As part of the Apprenticeship Week last year, I visited Glenmorangie in West Lothian, and this year I visited Livingston Mechanical Services. These are both fantastic businesses with great opportunities for those wanting to do apprenticeships. Glenmorangie offered a tailored apprenticeship qualification, demonstrating their commitment to the programme and the value it brings to their business, as well as the opportunities it presents to young people. It offers a balance between learning and hands-on experience within a team environment that nurtures and coaches them throughout the 14-month programme. The apprentices came from various backgrounds, and some had come from school, while others, if I recall rightly, had graduated from university with degrees ranging from English literature, forensic chemistry. Apprenticeships are for everyone. So speaking to those apprentices gave me a real insight into the invaluable opportunity these positions present to them, earning while they learn and gaining formal qualifications that accelerate their development and create a real springboard for their careers and support our economy. The morning spent at Livingston Mechanical Services was particularly relevant to some of the messages we continue to hear from businesses and young people. Livingston Mechanical offer apprenticeships in electrical engineering. The apprentices told me of the invaluable insight and experience they gained from installing EV charging bays at RBS at Gogarburn to the construction and installation of air conditioning units from flat sheet metal. It was quite inspiring. And what struck me was how much value the young people place on their opportunity and how committed the business's senior leaders were and are to supporting training and retaining these young people in their business. But what was of grave concern to me was the route that these young people had taken to get their apprenticeships. And I want to caveat this also by stating that these were from across many geographical areas, West Lothian, Glasgow and Lanarkshire. And without exception, these young people found out about these invaluable apprenticeships through their own family or social networks. The school career guidance teachers had no role whatsoever at all. I'd be hard-placed to find anything positive from that part of the conversation with the apprenticeships to share in the chamber today. There is no doubting the vital role further education plays in Scotland, but more must be done. The Scottish Conservatives will restore the excellence in Scottish schools and want more investment in vocational and technical qualifications so that every child has the chance to succeed no matter what their background. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Webber. I now call Bob Dorris to be followed by Daniel Johnson. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Dorris.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And this is a timely debate, as I think my committee convener, Sue Webber, just illustrated with our committee report on college regionalisation just published today. But in the first instance, it is an opportunity to celebrate the increased prominence and importance of vocational and technical qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools. Important not for self-praise by government, but to raise the profile, the status and the parity of esteem that members across this chamber want to see for such vocational technical skills. It's important we celebrate where there is success to make sure we tackle that status gap and address it and put it a parity of esteem at the heart of what we do in government. But when looking at the impact, we must look at outcomes. Are young people leaving schools equipped to take on the opportunities that exist in the workplace for further learning? Well, statistics from 21-22 offer strong evidence of positive outcomes, with 95.7% of those finishing school in that year progressing their studies or careers within 3 months of the end of that school year. That strong performance by our young people is an increase on the previous year. I actually acknowledge Stephen Kerr's point in relation to some of this. I think we'd welcome some longitudinal data and where young people are 1, 2, 3 years down the line in relation to that. So we can be positive, Mr Kerr, and still be challenging about how we can do better. But there's light and shade in the debate, Mr Kerr, and maybe that's something you're still to develop in this chamber, perhaps. It is also hugely encouraging to learn that the gap in securing such positive destinations for those from our most deprived backgrounds is reduced by two-thirds since 2009-2010, and it sits at just 4.4%. Of course, our students and our schools must be commended on this success, but we should also commend the role of Scotland's colleges. Indeed, the report from the Education Committee in which I sit, which we've referred to earlier, just hot off the press published today, is clear about the strong links between colleges and schools. We believe this has been strengthened in recent years. In John Paul Academy, a secondary school in my constituency in Somerston in Maryhill, gives a very good example of that. In their inspection report, published just last month from the inspector, it says the school's provision of vocational pathways shows particular strength and gives an appropriately high status to these options. Staff actively promote the wide range of options linked to apprenticeships. They work well with a range of partners to offer relevant vocational pathways. This has a positive impact on those young people who are furthest from the jobs market and living challenging lifestyles. Factual, evidence-based, good progress and success in our schools. And colleges are key delivery partners with schools in developing young workforce initiatives. Under developing the young workforce, foundation apprenticeships have been used since 2016 to provide young people with a strong start in a career by providing industry-recognised qualifications and the experience that employers are looking for. Glasgow Kelvin College, based in Springburn, in my constituency, for example, offer the following foundation apprenticeships in civil engineering, mechanical engineering, social services for children and young people, and creative and digital media. Would they be able to get the time back?
Yes, Mr. Dorris.
Thank you.
Michael Marr.
Appreciate the member giving way. Thank you. I appreciate the member giving way. And does he'll have heard the calls, as I have, from colleges in Glasgow regarding this £26 million of funding in the budget. Does he believe it's incumbent on ministers today to provide clarity as to what that money can be spent on to support the colleges that serve his constituency?
Bob Dorris.
Can I say to the member that I'm in active engagement on that exact point? I'll address that later on in my contribution, Mr. Mara. I am sure that the key partnership between schools, colleges and business underpinned by the support of the Scottish Government is one of the factors which led, for example, Presiding Officer, to Scotland having a higher employment rate, a lower unemployment rate and a lower inactivity rate for 16 to 24-year-olds in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK. The Scottish Funding Council, college principals and senior figures from developing the young workforce have highlighted that as a result of the strengthened relationship between colleges and the local schools, there is now more support available for young people transitioning from schools to colleges. Sir Peter Scott, the former Commissioner for Fair Access, stated that colleges working more closely with schools allow pupils to combine academic and vocational courses, vital in addressing the status issue and the parity of esteem. And he went on to say This could ease the transition from school to post-school further education study and potentially offer students from more socially disadvantaged backgrounds the opportunity to progress into higher education. Absolutely. But we should, of course, look at the financial position of colleges. We should not deny the financial challenges that Scotland's colleges face. A different budget decision could have been taken. But we should be frank, no one in this chamber, government or opposition, suggested a different budgetary path for Scotland's colleges. It would be wrong to suggest otherwise. The additional cash that was identified during the budget process came from government, not opposition, and that was an additional £26 million, which the college sector warmly welcomed. But we do need clarity about that £26 million. Will it be embedded into future financial settlements for the sector? That will make a significant difference to choices colleges make just now, as they struggle planning for the following academic year in relation to course provision and student numbers. So we do need clarity on that, and I'm absolutely happy to put that on the record. Can I also say, in relation to apprenticeships, we've heard in relation to this chamber, and it brings back, we've heard about in this chamber, and it's in relation to the budgetary position again. I would love to have a light and shade discussion in this chamber about how we as a government and as a society can flex up apprenticeship numbers to respond to the changing business needs and demands within the wider economy. But that has a budgetary implication. We shouldn't just demand it and not will the cash that follows to support that. So I think there's a lot of great success in relation to vocational and technical education. We should celebrate that, not to praise government, but to praise schools, young people, the students, the colleges, the businesses, who are doing extending work
Doris, I have
in
given
difficult
you a bit of
decisions. But if we want to spend more as a parliament, we have to will where that cash comes from, not just assert it.
Thank you, Mr Doris. And I now call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Emma Harper. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. The subject of vocational education and training is a hot topic everywhere across the world, for some very clear reasons. And indeed, I think Willie Rennie pointed out, we are in the middle of huge economic change. The need to drive towards net zero means that we need to skill people up with a different set of skills compared to the current workforce. Technology change means that we need to ensure that people, in whatever profession, whatever trade they are doing, can use technology and computers. And above all else, we are living in an age when we have a declining population, which means we cannot just afford to sit back and see where people might end up. We need to make sure that every single person is employed using their capacities and their talents to the best of their ability, because we can't afford to do otherwise. So it's not just here, it's why in Germany, in Denmark, in Austria, in France, across the world, we see governments challenging and asking fundamental questions of their vocational and education training systems. And that's why it's not good enough, really, for the government to come forward with a motion just setting out about what we've done, about what is good, without actually setting about the challenges and vision, because no country can afford to do that. And the reality is this. Across the OECD, 42% of secondary education students are enrolled in vocational education training courses. 42%. And yet we have a situation in Scotland where we can't quite compare the numbers between who's studying in vocational courses and nationally certificated courses. We don't have that clarity. And I think therein lies the problem. Therein lies the challenge. Because we need a vocational system that is...
Stephen Kerr.
Giving way. So he will share, I hope, my concerns that we know there are some colleges where the principals are talking about laying off one in four of their lecturers and perhaps even envisaging closing down whole departments. That is not the scene that would fit with what he is saying.
Daniel Johnson.
Absolutely. I would agree with that concern, because very naturally colleges are seen as a hub for vocational learning. And we also hear from college principals what they say to me is they can't meet the demand that is being asked of them by employers coming to them. So I think we do have an issue. But we need a vocational system where we boost uptake, we increase the usefulness of those schemes, and we have wider acceptance. We need to start with clarity. Because if you look at the SQA website, you look at government stats, we don't have a clear and comparable basis for looking at the numbers. And I think you almost had that acknowledgement from the Cabinet Secretary here this afternoon. And while we saw progress with SCQF, putting everything on a common benchmark, what we don't have is the equivalent vocational qualification. So you can point to what is the equivalent to a National 5, the equivalent to a higher, that we all understand and trust. Ultimately, we need to get to a situation where our grannies know and trust and understand what the value of the qualifications that our young people are undertaking. You know, if we look at other countries, we have these clear cut. We understand in Switzerland, 65% of people go through vocational education training programmes through a two-year programme in the main. Others will go through a federal diploma, which takes 4 years. I.e., you understand the system. You can point to the numbers, which is what we can't do here. But I think if we look further at other international comparisons, I think we see, I think, what we need to do. So first of all, is we need that integration between academic and vocational systems. If we look at France, the French baccalaureate is split into three streams. We have an academic, a technical, and a vocational. And in fact, I think that's one of these elements that has been missed in the debate. The difference between technical education and vocational education is one which is completely absent from our debate, but a fundamental one if you listen to the debate in other countries. Secondly, these schemes need to be employer-led. If we look at the Swiss system, that is the fundamental basis that drives its utility and value, both to those participating in those schemes, but also the businesses themselves, which is why 26% of businesses in Switzerland take part in apprenticeship schemes, compared to 16% in Scotland. And I would note the number for the rest of the UK is 19%, something for us to think about. And the final point is clear progression into work. And while we have, I think, value, and we have made progress through the Developing the Young Workforce programme, through things like foundation apprenticeships, what we don't have necessarily is that same seamless integration between the different stages of vocational training and into work. What we need is that ability for people to obtain qualifications at school that allow them to immediately access work in a seamless way, in a way that is understood by employers, and indeed, I would say, led by employers. And that is clearly what employers are saying if we listen to things such as the CIPD survey, where 52% are saying they struggle to get relevant skills, and only 20% viewed schools as being effective. There is clearly a huge need for change. And I'd posit one suggestion. I've already pointed to the French baccalaureate and how they integrate their vocational training. Less than around 120 people take the Scottish baccalaureate. It is a feature of the Scottish education system that has been forgotten about. Why couldn't we look at a Scottish baccalaureate, one that integrates both academic learning and vocational learning, one that puts them on a comparable basis, one where you can actually study both academic and vocational qualifications at the same time? Because ultimately, that's what's important. Both vocational qualifications being seen as important, as robust, as rigorous and as valuable as academic learning, but actually also vocational learning being reinforced by academic learning. Because ultimately, if you are studying for engineering to be an electrician, you want those people to be studying mathematics and physics, to have the two working hand in hand, integrated, and sharing not just a quality of esteem, but an equality of rigour, and indeed, ultimately, value to both business and people learning. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. And I now call Emma Harper, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate and have enjoyed listening to contributions from other members so far this afternoon. The benefits of the Scottish Government's significant investment in young people are evident thanks to the Developing the Young Workforce strategy and the Young Persons Guarantee. A record number of 95.7% of school leavers in 2021-22 were progressing their studies or careers within 3 months of leaving school. And youth employment and vocational qualifications are one part of this government's strong, demonstrable track record of achievements in education. And the record speaks for itself, but today I'm going to focus on vocational qualifications in our rural sector and indeed the jobs of the future and the green skill jobs that we need to protect our future in terms of the climate emergency. And I think I'm the only member to mention rural skills so far this afternoon. And again, Presiding Officer, I think that's really important. The Scottish Vocational Qualification in Agriculture at SCQF Level 5 provides learners with the knowledge and skills that they need for agricultural work with either crops or livestock. The SVQ covers areas such as monitoring and maintaining health, safety and security, developing an awareness of environmental good practice and how to manage and improve the rural business environment. It also includes optional units such as preparing and operating farm vehicles, preparing feed and water supplies for livestock, and monitoring and maintaining the healthy growth of crops. Upon successful completion, learners will gain an internationally recognised qualification which guarantees that they have the knowledge, the skills and the abilities that are required to carry out their roles successfully. Rural employers will also benefit from their employees being proficient in the skill set required. Last year, I joined Tracy McEwen at Tarf Valley at Ringford in Dumfries and Galloway and at a dairy farm near Gelston, along with career advisers from the local secondary schools. Tracy and the team explained and demonstrated to the careers advisers what rural employment opportunities are available for young people across Dumfries and Galloway. The feedback from the Insight Day was extremely valuable. Young people taking part in courses like the one at Tarf that I described covered a range of mentor-supported topics and complete on-farm direct workplace assessments to show competence in specific tasks. Tarf also offer pre-apprenticeship programmes which allows young people of school age to be supported by a mentor in their placement who will help prepare them for work. These apprenticeship programmes are really important in getting people into agriculture, particularly as the sector has an ageing workforce, and absolutely it's vital for our nation's food security, especially with the current economic and Brexit challenges facing the sector. I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister to always keep rural skills and rural education at the forefront of ongoing education and skills work. And presiding officer, in turning to green skills, as we continue to recover from the pandemic, we must build a fairer economy that delivers the skills, the opportunities and the jobs for the future that will help secure our just transition to net zero and tackle the climate emergency. Scotland is already investing in green skills and attracting new green job opportunities. The launch of the Green Jobs Workforce Academy is a welcome step in preparing our current and future workforce to seize the opportunities afforded to Scotland as part of the just transition to net zero. The Academy, supporting people across multiple locations and online, is guiding people of all ages through a process of identifying the skills they have and the skills that they will need to find and secure green jobs for the future. I'm keen to see that the south of Scotland plays a part in this green skills strategy as well. And recently I visited the Scottish Borders College, the Hoyt campus, where I saw firsthand the work that they are doing to support people into green skills jobs, but also to upskill those already in the sector. The college are leading vocational courses on building properties to passive house standard, on installing ground source heat pumps, on electric charging infrastructure, and on solar panel installation and repair. However, one of the limitations the college relayed to me is that the funding model to get these courses up and running is restrictive, and if the college wanted to offer these courses to those in school, the funding would not support it. So I therefore ask the Minister in his closing if he would be open to meeting with me and the Borders College to discuss the specific funding issues highlighted at my visit last Monday. I would also be remiss not to mention the work of Dumfries and Galloway College. Stranraer and Dumfries campuses both are supporting green skills, particularly in the wind turbine engineering sector, and I commend their work that they're taking forward. So, presiding officer, I know I could probably expand a little, but I actually prepared a shorter speech this afternoon, expecting some folk would intervene, especially because I'm the only person talking about rural skills, which are absolutely necessity and important for us in Scotland. So, yes, I will take an intervention.
A brief intervention, Ms Gallagher, please.
I thank Emma Harper for giving way. She spoke a lot about positive destinations, and I'm just wondering if the member agrees with me that positive destinations should be measured over a longer time than 12 months, particularly when we're looking at rural and jobs affecting climate change in our environment.
Emma Harper.
I thank Megan Gallagher for that intervention. I think it's it's really important that we take our data or we gather data in many different ways. So 12 months plus longer term would be valuable. I think it is really useful that we explore how we manage the data and then what we do with it. So finally, Presiding Officer, I realise I'm soon out of time. The Scottish Government has succeeded in meeting its goal to reduce youth unemployment by 40% after actively pursuing the DYW Youth Employment Strategy. And building on this, the Scottish Government is continuing to expand opportunities available to young people. And I repeat that agriculture and green skills have an absolutely crucial role to play here. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And we will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Martin Whitfield to wind up on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to close this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour, who, like I think all across this chamber and indeed across Scotland, the United Kingdom and indeed the world, support the expansion of vocational and technical education in school settings. It's common sense. If we look to our past, if we look far to our past, way before even Scottish education was heralded as great in the world, the idea of vocational training for a young person lay at the crux of what their childhood was actually about. And it is right that we serve all of our children, those people who want to pursue an academic future, but also those who want to pursue a vocational and indeed a technical future. We should trust the choices that our young people make, and we should allow them to grow up in an environment where they have those choices, where they can see them, where they can dream about a better future that fits in with what they want. From that very powerful discussion from Pam Gosell about her own experience with her son, about someone being able at last to communicate to adults the sort of learning they want to do so they can have the sort of future they want, was incredibly powerful to hear. And I compliment her and her son on sharing that, because I think of all of the discussion, which has been very wide-ranging today, I think that speaks to what vocational training should be for our young people. But how have we got to where we are today in a debate that, interestingly, has strayed far away from our secondary schools and the vocational training that is available there through apprenticeship last week, indeed into our colleges and back to our colleges and to our colleges again, and rightly so. But it is interesting to look at where we are. And if we start with the Muir report, which of course talked and sought answers with regard to our whole education system, and the evidence that he received that there is confidence in the curriculum for excellence up until that senior phase. And actually, it is the great unanswered part of curriculum for excellence from when it first came in, that we never really addressed the senior phase because perhaps it was too great of a challenge, or perhaps it goes to the lack of parity of esteem for those who want to do vocational training as compared to those that want to pursue an academic path forward. More than welcome to.
Fergus Hume.
Mr Whitfield and indeed the Labour Party have some sympathy in including in the curriculum in Scotland the extension of the provision, the universal provision preferably, of the skill of touch typing to our children in schools? Is that something that the Labour Party may wish to espouse?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Fergus Hume for that intervention, and he spoils the fact that I in fact was going to make reference to his intervention during the main debate to share with him my belief that touch typing skills, like many of those fundamental skills, should be available to our young people, actually to make their future easier. So I move quickly to the Hayward review, merely for comment about the senior phase leaving certificate that's been raised in the interim report, but also that which has been echoed by a number of people here today about a better and more clearly defined integration of academic and vocational qualifications. And I think it speaks volumes to the language of vocational training, the granny test, I think, as Daniel Johnson so aptly put it, that actually if your granny doesn't understand what you're doing, you know, she might not put your beans on for when you get home. But if she does, she will push you. She will get you out of bed to get you at school to your vocational training. And I think we are still a long way from a true understanding across all of our communities about the vocational training, the language we use, and the opportunities that are available to our young people. It would be remiss of me not to mention Willie Rennie, given that I was going to use that as my link into your intervention, Mr. Ewing. But I think it is right to say that this debate shouldn't just be about self-congratulation, and there is a desperate need for better data as to where our young people are going, rather than a snapshot 3 months after they depart school, because I am aware, admittedly on a subjective basis, of young people who perhaps not long after that three-month snapshot found themselves unemployed and in difficult, challenging positions, and actually sought support back from the school, which they tried to give, but was outwith their requirement, which is disappointing. I've mentioned Pam Gosell because she did rightly mention the £26 million that has come into so many people's speeches about colleges, and it would be nice to know whether or not they can spend it and what they can spend it on. I would also like to raise the input from Ruth Maguire about the debate in 2018 and the work with regard to gender balance and other groups. And I think that speaks a lot to what we have heard, particularly Stuart McMillan, and I would like to echo his comments about those that suffer from dyslexia and the challenge that they have, but also to our disabled, both visible and invisible disability, and the need for our pathways to work for every young person in Scotland. It's right to mention Carol Mockin, as I do, because of the narrowing of the choices that are available to our young people. And I think that is a reality that I think it would be helpful if this government would admit, because all of the evidence is suggesting that in our schools that serve our poorer communities, the choices that are available are smaller than those in other areas. And to Emma Harper, as time is tight, I will say that I haven't been chockied with this debate at all. It's been a great pleasure to read your email for the East of Scots, and I thought it would be worthy to put it on the record. But you are right to speak about our agricultural vocational training and the huge value that is across not just the south of Scotland, but indeed large areas of Scotland. Because the great value of vocational training is we can offer to our young people what our young people want, what our young people imagine. And it can't be beyond the wit of this place and this government to actually address those needs in the years to come. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call on Megan Gallagher to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms. Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a Scottish Conservative, I believe in aspiration. But aspiration can only be achieved when governments provide people with the tools to succeed in life. My own education journey hit speed bump after speed bump, and at some points I thought about giving up completely. When I was at school, there wasn't a proper support network or careers advice, and that resulted in many young people in my hometown falling through the cracks in the education system, and I could have been one of them. For a high school pupil in the mid-2000s, not achieving a space at university was a sign of failure. Yeah. There were never really a mention or focus on vocational and technical qualifications, and if you said you wanted to go to college, it was because you were not intelligent enough to go to university. The truth is, I had no idea what I wanted to do when I was in sixth year. And combine that with the stigma around non-academical subjects, I lost interest in schooling during my senior years. This resulted in me not obtaining the grades that I should have and becoming one of the few Scots who have repeated their final year of high school. I ended up going to university as that was the done thing, not because it was right for me. Things did turn out okay, but for some of my friends and people I went to school with, it led to them dropping out of university. There was no support and no clear pathway for them. But that's why I am pleased that I am able to close today's debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, not just because I was nearly someone who fell through the cracks, but because this government needs to do more to support our young people. We need to keep telling our young people that there is no wrong path and that success should not be measured by the number of degrees you have obtained. Professor Hayward's interim report has been referenced a few times today, and I do welcome the outward thinking to get our young people engaged in choosing their own future. Yes, of course.
Daniel Johnson.
I apologise if this is a bit of a tangent, but I actually think the question isn't whether or not you're vocational or university education. Actually, one of the things we need to challenge is our universities to ensure that they actually deliver skills and can demonstrate their vocational relevance regardless of what subject you do.
Megan Gallagher.
I couldn't agree more with Daniel Johnson, and I think that's incumbent on all of us to make sure that we are challenging that narrative in our universities. And when we actually look at the expansion, if you let me make some progress, I'll come back to you. When looking at the expansion of vocational and technical qualifications, we need to understand the current environment for our young people for young people experience. They are up against nearly 1,000 schools not being inspected, 140,000 fewer college places, knowledge that they are worth nearly £2,500 less if they go to college rather than university, an ever-widening attainment gap between the poorest and richest pupils, and 1,699 fewer teachers. These are the reasons why young people fall through the gaps. I'm happy to give way.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank Megan Gallagher for taking the intervention when she touched upon her own experience. I'm a wee bit older than Megan Gallagher, I would imagine, but certainly people of my generation growing up in the 1980s, there were no opportunities for people by way of apprenticeships in the west coast of Scotland because the apprenticeship schemes had been scrapped and jobs had been lost. So the only offer for many people was to attempt to get to university. Does Megan Gallagher agree with that?
Megan Gallagher?
Well, you know, I'm not going to disagree with that at all, because there is different career paths for everybody, and I think we can all understand that there are challenges that young people face while growing up. But as we've heard today from Sue Webber, for example, from Pam Gossel, you know, apprenticeships as it stands just now are a challenge for young people actually to get into, and it's only when they're reaching out to their friends and family that they can actually access an apprenticeship. So I think we need to look at the overall picture, and I gave my experience because that was just one of many experiences in terms of a young person's experience as they go through the education system. Presiding officer, this government does need to do more to provide the tools for young people to succeed. The Cabinet Secretary began her contribution by congratulating the successes of our young people, which we will all applaud, but I don't think she mentioned these achievements were made in spite of the problems within our education system, and that the government has presided over these issues over the last 15 years. My colleague Stephen Kerr rightly pointed out the many challenges that this Parliament faces to ensure that our young people flourish. And he's right, because we need the talent, and that must be addressed by attracting people into our education sector to inspire the next generation. Michael Mara spoke about the broadening of subject choice for young people, stating that the stakes have never been higher for many young people trying to enter college or university. Yes, happy to give way.
Ferguson?
She's very generous. Member's very generous in giving way. Does Megan Gallagher agree with me that the challenges that young people meet could well be addressed by extending the skills that they can acquire to those of being able to touch type, which is so useful across a whole range of things? And could I ask, is the Conservative Party, like the Labour Party, attracted towards this policy?
Megan Gallagher.
Come on, Mr Ewing, you've ruined the punchline for my colleague over in the Labour benches. You've now ruined it for me. But yes, we do absolutely support your cause, and we'll back your mission to make sure that that's seen as a core skill. I do understand, presiding officer, that time's ticking away, so if members can forgive me for not taking any more interventions, just so I can get a couple of more points in. Sue Webber mentioned people who choose to enter education later in life and the challenges they face when looking to find a career or job. And they do need support from this government too. And Pam Gossel mentioned her son and his experience of finding a pathway that works for him. And I'm really pleased that he managed to find the apprenticeship that was right for him. But as we've spoken about so frequently today, too many people are falling through the cracks because they're not being able to be signposted to the right place for support. Before I conclude, presiding officer, I do want to raise the issue of how positive destinations are recorded, and I completely understand why positive destinations are recorded, but, and it is a huge but, it only records data within the first 3 months of leaving and then 12 months after leaving. And in 2020-21, 71% of school leavers looked after within the last year were in a positive follow-up destination, down from 86% in a positive initial destination. Yeah. So we know that that was a decrease, but have no idea of the journey for those young people thereafter. There is no concrete data as it stands. Yeah. Therefore, I would be grateful if the Minister could expand on this during his closing contribution and explain why the government only focuses on the first year at present. Presiding officer, as always with education-related debates, it has been a lively afternoon with many passionate contributions made. But the reality is this. While we talk about the expansion of vocational and technical qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools, there will be young people facing an uncertain future as they approach their final exams. So I'll end by challenging the next government. Back our young people by making sure they have the tools to succeed in life. back our young people by putting their priorities first and proving to them that regardless of whatever they want to do in life, this government will support them. Thank you.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Ms Gallagher. And I now call on Jamie Hepburn, Minister, to wind up the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government. And if the Minister could take us to decision time, that would be much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I welcome the contributions that have been made? Can I preempt Fergus Ewing's impending intervention to say the Scottish Government recognises the importance of touch typing? In terms of the tone of the debate, can I... I mean, there was a purpose to me preempting the intervention, but why not?
Fixing.
Well, generous as always, could I commend two maxims to the Minister? First, if you can't beat them, join them. And second, it's better to jump rather than be pushed. And in that spirit, can I put this very kindly, would the Scottish Government be willing to reconsider its current approach, which appears to be not actively to advance the universal extension of touch typing skills to all children in our schools?
Minister.
Well, the member will be aware we don't have a set curriculum, but I'm sure teachers the length and breadth of the country will be interested in his perspective as to the advantages of touch typing. Returning to the debate, Presiding Officer, in terms of the tone of the debate, let me first of all say I recognise it is entirely incumbent on opposition members to raise concerns. It's entirely fair and right to raise concerns. I wouldn't suggest for a moment there aren't challenges within our education system. It's incumbent upon us to recognise and respond to. But part of the purpose of today's debate, and there is something to be said for having a debate explicitly to celebrate the achievements of young people in Scotland. And in that sense, we've heard some of that, but I think not enough of that over the course of today's debate. If I could say to Mr Rennie, I thought it got off to a good start when he mentioned that he visits the schools in his constituency, but I didn't hear one word, not a single utterance from him about the achievements within those schools. Not once did I hear it from Mr Rennie. Nothing specific about specific achievements in the area of vocational and technical qualifications. Of course, I'll give you...
Willie Rennie?
I can deliver my whole speech again, if the Minister would like. But I... but I hear cries of yes, but...
there isn't any time, Mr Rennie.
but I have repeatedly praised my local schools and the contribution they make, and I referred to that in my contribution as well. But this chamber is about change and improvement. I just wish the government would do a little bit more of that.
Minister.
Well, maybe what I should have said is I didn't think Mr Rennie got the balance quite right, and that's my perspective on the matter. But I think it is important for us to place the debate in the context that we have. Let me first of all, though, say we have heard from members about the importance of vocational technical qualifications, but I do agree, and I think there's been a sense of this, that there is sometimes a false distinction drawn between supposed academic, the pursuit of supposed academic qualification against the pursuit of supposed vocational education. And in that sense, I think the messaging that we send out from here is important, because we should be pressing the issue of parity of esteem for multiple purposes, so that we know that the various options, and there are increased range of options, I'll come to that in a minute, the range of options that young people have in school, none is any better than the other. They are all good options for young people to pursue. And in that sense, I thought the point made by Bob Dorris, that the message we send out over the course of this debate is an important one as well. We have to make sure that we are sending out that message very loudly, very clearly, that there is parity of esteem across the provision of our education system. I'll give
Daniel
you
Johnson.
I'm very grateful to Mr. Fielman. I wonder if he would agree with the insight then that the comparison with France, where you've got complete integration, is one that we need to aspire to. One where we have vocational qualifications, where you can point to the equivalent of a higher, that's the vocational qualification, and that's what will ultimately deliver that parity of esteem and understanding.
Minister.
Well, we actually do have that in our system just now. Of course, Louise Hayward is looking at more activity in this regard. But if you look at foundation apprenticeships, for example, they're set at SEQF level 6, just the same way as a higher is. So there is the ability to look across and compare. In that regard, that allows me to make the very point about the progress that we have made. And I take the point that was made, again, by Mr Johnson, that other countries in the OECD have a much higher proportion of vocational provision in their school system. But if you actually look at the journey we have been on, we have made tremendous progress. If you look at 2013-14, there were only 7.3% of vocational technical qualifications at SEQF level 5 and above being provided in schools. In 21-22, that was 27.2%. That is significant progress, and that is something that I think each and every one of us should welcome. I'll give way very briefly to Mr Kerr.
So on the basis of what the Minister is saying, why is it that we don't spend every penny of the apprenticeship levy that comes to Scotland, why don't we spend every penny of that money on apprenticeships? Why is there a cap on apprenticeships? And when everyone is saying in industry the cap is too low, why doesn't the Minister respond and raise the limits?
Minister.
Well, I think the first thing I would say is that we don't have the precise sight on the manner in which the apprenticeship levy is raised. It was introduced by the UK government, not by the Scottish government. So I couldn't earnestly tell you the global sum that we would have at our disposal, because we don't collect it. But it would also fundamentally alter the provision of our skills system. And I know Mr Kerr wasn't elected at this time, but when the levy was introduced, as unwelcome as it was by those who had to pay it, they said to us not to spend it all in its entirety on the provision of apprenticeships and to have more plurality of provision. But if you want to talk about apprenticeship numbers, I'm happy to reflect on over the last five-year period. Yes, certainly we have some way to go back through COVID disruption, but if you look at 5 years ago, there were 27,422 apprenticeship starts. In 21-22, we were down to 26,567. We'll be up again this year. That was a 3.2% drop. If you look at what happened in England under the Conservative tenure, I see Mr Kerr's not interested in that, but I'm interested in that because it's about the apprenticeship levy raised by the UK government for the express purposes of their policy of increasing the number of apprenticeships in England. If you look at that same period of time, there was a 7.1% decline in the number of apprentices in England. So let me turn to colleges and their interaction with schools, because they play a vital role in the provision of interaction for senior phase pupils in terms of technical and vocational level qualifications. And I am pleased to see the range of activity that happens across Scotland's colleges in that regard. There was made mention of the additional funding that we have provided. That will be provided to colleges in the usual fashion through budget allocations by SFC. There's been dialogue between SFC, as you would expect, and the college sector. We asked them to undertake that work, and that will become clearer in short order. Can I say to Emma Harper, I will not give way to Mr Marr because I'm feeling petty and immature, and he didn't give way to me on two occasions, so I'll carry on with what I was going to say. Emma Harper may have asked me the wrong week to visit a board committee meeting Borders College, but I'm happy to either commit for me or my successor to meet with her. Presiding Officer, let me also reflect the fact that we heard from many members around the range of activity that we see in Scotland schools. I'm pleased to be able to see, when I've been out about, visit Roman High School in January, saw first class provision of vocational learning. Tomorrow I'll be going to the Developing Young Workforce Edinburgh Roadshow, where schools from across the city will be attending to see some of that activity. Just this morning I was at Gorgie Mills, an ASN school in Edinburgh, where they are undertaking activity related to making sure that their young people are better prepared for the world of work. That's what we should be talking about. There is excellence in our education system in terms of the Developing Young Workforce approach, in terms of promoting and advancing the provision of technical qualifications, because at the end of the day, Presiding Officer, that's what we should be focused on. And I want to finish with one message. There should be no wrong path for young people in our country. Irrespective of what their preferred end destination must be, it is incumbent on us to make sure that we do everything we can to support them. That's exactly what this government is committed to and will remain committed to make sure that our young people have the best chance in life.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on expansion of vocational and technical qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. There are three questions to be put as a result. Point of order, Edward Mount.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 16th of March, the Deputy First Minister announced yet another delay of an additional 6 months to both vessels 801 and 802. However, the Deputy First Minister said the ferries would be handed over to CalMac in autumn 23 and autumn 24. He chose his words carefully because handed over, of course, does not mean operational. I pressed this specific point and he said he was unable to answer, leaving CalMac to confirm they would not be operational for a further 2 to 3 months. Now, Presiding Officer, you have said that members, as a matter of a respect to each other, should answer questions truthfully. It is clear the Deputy First Minister, by refusing to answer the question that I asked, was hiding the fact that he knew the ferries would not be operational for another 2 to 3 months after the date that he had given. Presiding Officer, I seek your advice on how a member can get honest and fulsome answers when it is clear that some ministers are not showing the Chamber the respect that you have asked them to.
Thank Mr. Mountain for his point of order. The Scottish Ministerial Code states that it is of paramount importance that ministers give full and accurate information to the Parliament, correcting any inadvertent factual errors at the earliest opportunity. And where a minister is not in a position to provide an answer at that point with regards to a question put to them, it is acceptable to offer to follow that up with information in writing. And if a member has a question about the factual accuracy of another member's contribution, they should raise it directly with the member in the first instance. And I know that the member will be aware that the Parliament has a procedure and how that operates. We'll continue on to a point of order, Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance this afternoon. Minister McCallum misled Scotland's coastal communities. The existing network of marine protected areas covers approximately 37% of Scotland's seas. The Greens and SNP, through their Bute House agreement, intend to designate 10% of Scottish seas as highly protected marine areas. At least part of the 10% will be over and above the 30% already designated as marine protected areas. In comparison, the EU's approach is designating strictly protected areas within the 30% already designated as MPAs. Presiding Officer, no other EU country has implemented HPMAs to the extent of the proposal from the Greens and SNP. There is no evidence to demonstrate that they will achieve their aims. Minister McCallum is being disingenuous when she states that Scotland is in line with the EU, and this matters, Presiding Officer, because fragile rural communities are under threat once again, just like they were during the Clyde Codpox debacle. It is no good throwing around this inaccurate data, which undermines the seriousness of this unevidenced policy approach from the SNP and Green government, and ignores the concerns of stakeholders and coastal communities. I regret, Presiding Officer, that this is becoming a regular occurrence, with SNP ministers frequently misleading this chamber. Yep. And I would appreciate your advice on this very serious matter.
Thank you, Ms. Hamilton. As I have previously drawn members' attention to, there is a mechanism which exists by which those who have provided information on the record have an opportunity to correct that information if they believe that there is a factual error existing. The member has had an opportunity to raise that with the chamber, and those points therefore are recorded. I'll move on now to decision time. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that amendment 8291.2 in the name of Stephen Kerr, which seeks to amend motion 8291 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville on expansion of vocational and technical qualifications in Scotland's secondary schools, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.